please help me welcome our pastor as she brings the word of God. Give her a hearty amen. Oh, it's good to be here. Yes, the Lord is so good and so wonderful. We're glad that you came to be with us this morning. He knew you were going to be here, so he gave me a message just for you. You will enjoy it. It'll strip you naked and then it'll clothe you again. Yes. If you have your Bible, turn with me to St. Matthew, the 14th chapter. Is it the 14th? Hold on. The 9th chapter. Father, we're grateful this morning for your blessings. You've been good to us, better than we've ever been to ourselves. We thank you, God, because you thought enough of us, that you would send your son to die and to give his life, that we may have an opportunity and a chance to make things right. We thank you because you cared enough that you were willing to give everything that you had, and that was your only son. We thank you, God, for all that you've done to make us who we are today. We thank you for grace and mercy, for love, for all the things that you could give to us. We praise you for it. I pray now, God, for the anointing upon thy servant, that you would give me what to give to your people, and we'll give you glory and honor in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. The 16th verse says, no man putteth a piece of new cloth unto an old garment, for that which is put in to fill it up taketh from the garment, and the rent is made worse. Neither do men put new wine into old bottles, else the bottles break, and the wine runneth out, and the bottle perish. But they put new wine into new bottles, and both are preserved. I want to preach to you a little while this morning. How many people go to church usually on a Sunday? I was watching a program the other night, or the other day, and this girl was looking for a husband. And she wanted all these things out of him. And so she said to him, will you go to church with me? Because I'm a religious person. He said, I'll party on Saturday night. I'll go to church with you on Sunday. That doesn't work. So how many people go to church and some even go to confession and still wonder, why do I still go back and do the same thing over again? Why do I keep repeating myself? Why do I say to myself, I am going to stop doing this, only to find myself back there doing it again? How many times have you said, especially people make these big things at the first of the year, and they say, you know, I'm going to do this and do that, I'm going to change all this, only to find out on the second day of January, you just blew it. Happens all the time. So, what's wrong? We got to ask ourselves, what's wrong? I really intended to do it. I really meant to do it. But you got to look at the fact that you can't do it by yourself. And sometimes we're trying to become a better person on the outside. But unless the heart gets cleaned up, unless the heart is changed, no matter how many times you tell yourself, I'm not going to do it, you're going to find yourself back there again. Because it has to happen within. We sing the song, sometimes something on the inside working on the outside. You've got to get changed inside. We were singing a song the other day that says, how can you do right with a do wrong mind? If your heart is full of wrong, it's going to produce wrong. You cannot, it's impossible to be a Christian just by going to church, signing the book, and say, I'm a Christian. There's more to it than that. How many people make that mistake and say, you know what? I need to change this and change that. But I just give up. I tried. I really gave it everything I had. Well, I can tell you right now, if all of us had just gave everything we had, none of us would be here. We had to have a greater power. A greater power. So he says, you can't put the old piece of cloth and throw it onto a new piece unless it looks bad. And that's what people try to do. They try to get the outside fixed up. I want to look better here, look better there. But in actuality, that's not working for you. Because you cannot fix it on the outside. not. If you look at the Bible, you'll know who's a Christian and who's not. But the heart must go through a transformation. It must be clean so that whatever comes out of the heart is clean. And the Bible says, out of a good heart proceed good things. Out of an evil heart proceed evil things. So I want something good coming from me. How do I get it? You got to go to the Lord and say, Lord, look, here I am. I tried it by myself. It does not work. I ask you to come into my heart and fill me with good and right things so that we can do right. I'm tired of messing up excuses and saying, well, you know, I really meant to do it, but things just didn't happen right. You don't have to say that when you're dealing with the Lord. You don't have to do that. So, everything that God gives us, He preserves it. I'm not a country girl, so I don't know much about people canning stuff and all that stuff, but I did know enough to know that when they preserve something, they put a seal on it. I think sometimes they put a little piece of, is a little piece of wax in there or something? It's what? A cloth? Okay, so let's just say put cloth in there, and then they seal it. My husband's mother was a country woman. He was too. God loves him. And she would send us peach preserves. And sometimes those peaches were kept for years because they had a seal on it. Once you break the seal on something, it won't last. So every Christian has to have the seal of God on you for you to keep that. Otherwise, you'll get it for today and be gone tomorrow. So you got to preserve it. And I used to think all the time when the preserves would come, I didn't like those big chunks of fruit. So I would put it in a blender and make my eyes more like jelly. Because I was a city girl, I didn't eat that. But every time you got a bottle of it, sometimes the fruit looked a little bit darker, but it was so good. So if you as a person makes up in your mind, I am going to let God change me. But you're going to have to surrender to Him for Him to change you. You can't just do that by yourself. And you can't do your thing and say, I want to be changed. You can't be changed unless you say, God, here I am. Do to me what needs to be done. You got to want to do it. You got to want to give yourself to Him so that He can make the change in your life. He wants to make you different. That's why He sent His Son, so that we would have the power. The scripture said, for this purpose was the Son of God manifested, that He might destroy the works of the devil. So that devil that was in all of us, and maybe in some of you this morning, you would say, I'd like to get him out, because he's running your life. He's telling you what to do and how to do it and when to do it. You'll never have victory with him living inside. He's got to vacate the premises. And that's your heart. Because, see, we were all born in sin, every one of us. And all of us wasn't right, and we were messed up. But when we went to God and said, Lord, change me, He changed me. He will change you the same way. But you got to want to do it. That we make all these excuses why we can't do things. That I'm weak to this, I'm weak to that. No, no, no. When you get Jesus in your heart, you won't be weak to stuff. You're weak to stuff because you only fix up the outside. The outside will not change it. You're, no matter what it looks like, you are who you are. I saw a movie some time ago that was on TV. And I think one was telling me about this movie, too. This woman, I think she was a school teacher. And she looked so innocent. Teaching school all day long. And come night, she was a real live hooker. And boy, you would see this woman go in there. Because when she was in school, she had hair all up in this bun bag. Looked very plain and simple. Honey, that woman flipped that hair loose and shook it around and put on her makeup and dressed up. I thought, let's see you make that dress become a change. From a school teacher to a hooker. That's a big difference. But you know what? That's the way some church people are. You come to church on Sunday morning, you hear the message preached, you clap your hand with amazing grace, how sweet the sound. But when you go out the door, you light up. Christians don't gap your eyes or something touches you a little bit. And then when church is out, you meet up with your hooker on the parking lot. I told her to pick me up after church. She didn't want to come. Or he didn't want to come. I said, meet me after church. So what I do, I come to church, and I still don't get my life together, and I go back out the door doing some of the same things I was doing before I came in. That's not Christian. You say, well, I think I'm a pretty good person. I go to church on Sunday. I mind my business. I treat my neighbors right, and I take care of my family. I do all these things. That won't make you a Christian. Those things can follow being a Christian, but it won't make you a Christian. Everybody do some good things sometimes. For the worst of us, we do some good things. As horrible as I was, every now and then I did something nice. I mean, here and there. But I wasn't a nice person. I was a horrible person. I couldn't speak English. I cursed all the time. Continuously. I was constantly fighting and beating up people. You can't go to church and come out and beat somebody up and say, well, I'm a Christian. No, you're not. And don't use profanity the time you get out the door and somebody calls you on the phone and you listen, what happened? Well, what the so-and-so is that? You're not a Christian. The Bible says you can't get a sweet and bitter water don't come from the same fountain. So if you're still using profanity, you're not a Christian. Yeah, well, I don't do it much. I just every now and then when somebody upset me, I say, you're not a Christian. Before I got saved, I mean, I was cursing and swearing when I was happy. I was cursing and swearing when I was sad. I was mad when everything was going good. I was mad when nothing was going good. So those things, we can switch back and forth like that. But you know what? If you really want to be changed, you got to come to God and say, Lord, here I am. I want you to change my life. Come into my heart. Make me whole again. Make me the vessel that you wanted to make me. We have to give over to him. We cannot just say, I want the Lord to do this and then, well, he didn't do it. You didn't let him do it. I said to the Lord about my sisters and brothers and family all the time. I said, Lord, save them if they'll let you. That's right, if they'll let you. My brother passed away Saturday morning. I thought, how many times did I pray, if he saved him, if he'll let you? Because everybody's not going to let God. That's a tragedy. I want to say, well, you have to lay down and shut up. You know what? If you go to the store, and you buy a steak, and you bring it home, and you get ready to cook it for, perhaps you may want to barbecue it on the grill, or you may want to put it in the oven and broil it, or do all these things, and maybe you're one of those people who like the fries, whatever. But if you come home and bring that steak, and you got a plan for how you want it, and that steak stands up and says, I don't want to be boiled. That steak is not yours. When it starts telling you, no, I don't want to be barbecued today, something is wrong. And that's just the way people are. They'll say, God, I want this, but here's how I want you to do it. If you just do it like this, it'll work for me. Now, I don't want to shout. I don't want to raise my hands and worship God. I don't want to do that. I don't want to talk in them tongues I hear them people talking in. I don't want that. You're not going to get anything till you come to God and say, Lord, here I am, give it all to me the way you want it. And be willing to take it. Instead of giving him all the pros and the cons of what you want and don't want. Say, you know, whatever you want to do, I'll take it. That's why some of you never change, because you never really say yes to God. Yes to your will, yes to your way, however you want to fix it, I accept that. No, we don't want to do that. There's some things I kind of still want to do, you know. I want God to make some changes in me, but I don't think everything in me is bad. If you're not saved, everything in you is bad. He needs to go in there and clean up the whole mess. And once he cleans it up, you're another person. Everybody knew when I got saved at home, when I went back home after traveling with my husband in the military and go back home, and they said, boy, Rose, you don't seem like the same person. I said, thank God I'm not. And my brother had the nerve to say to me, I want my old sister back. I thought, why would you want her back? She was stone crazy. She's fighting and cursing everywhere she went. She is no good. Why would you want that old girl back? Because man is still living there himself. I can relate to you if you will just be back to the old person. I wanted no parts of her. I had it with that girl. She was always doing something she shouldn't do. She was always mad at somebody. She went to bed mad, get up mad, just mad about everything. Why would I want to go get that? Think about what's sitting on the pew this morning. You as a person, if you haven't been changed, how long do you want to stay with that old person? The person that nobody really likes. The people that don't want to see you coming and rather lock the door and act like they're not home when you on the way. Look at it. And say, you know, I'm a miserable person. I'm not happy. So how am I going to get happy? You have to have a change in your heart. It will make the difference in how happy you are. There's a lot of people that look like they're happy. But happiness is something you have every day. And it goes down into the depths of who you are. That no matter what's going on in your life, no matter what the situation is, I'm still happy. I'm not controlled by circumstances and situations, whether or not I have joy today. No matter what happens, I'm going to have joy because God has put it down inside of me. He said, I put into you a river. A river. A river of living water. So it's putting you and it keeps going and going and going and it keeps you happy. Have you ever looked at somebody and thought, boy, were you unhappy? You sure look like it. But if you are happy, there is no mistaking it. Happy people just make you want to say hi. If people look another way when they see you coming, what is it? What is it? Because I don't want to be around you. Something about it just makes me feel unhappy. I don't know. You want to be around people that are happy. And you want to bring happiness to other people. You want to say it's going to be all right. We can't tell people it's going to be all right because we don't believe it's going to be all right. So we're in a mess. We're in a mess. Trying to make some changes on our own and finding out it is impossible to do. You cannot do it. So, the more I look at this, I understand the importance of us being free from who we are. You got to be break free. It's a yoke around your neck, believe it or not. Your sin is a yoke. And it just binds you up and make you do things you don't want to do and say things you sick of saying and all these things. You just constantly in a bad place. Think about it. All over this room, I wouldn't be surprised there weren't people that had to take some kind of pill just to feel better this morning. I don't know. Life just, it's not what it's supposed to be. Do you know what I found out? Life is what you make it to be. It's what you make it to be. I can get up this morning and say, I'm going to be happy today. Or I can say, I'm going to start off having a behind it by the end of the day. And I'll tell them where I'm going to be. Come on. And the power of the tongue. You can speak life or you can speak death. You can speak happiness or you can speak depression. Whatever it is. But you've got to realize I got the power to speak this to myself if I give my life to God and let Him change me. Then what I say has power. Get up in the morning, look in the mirror, and whoa, what a great day. I don't care if it's raining, what a great day. I don't care if there's trouble in your life, what a great day, because it could be a lot worse than it is right now. It could be, yes. So, you say, well, I went to church and I thought I gave my heart to the Lord. I joined the church. That's not giving your heart to the Lord. Join the church. Don't do it. You join the church afterwards. Okay, I gave my heart to the Lord. Now I want to be a part of a church. I want to come here and be spiritually fed and blessed. Now I can do this. But we get the cart before the horse. We can't do that. Well, I got baptized today. That didn't change the heart. The heart has to get changed. Then go get baptized. Then it makes a difference. But if you have not been changed, going down in that water is not going to change you. It takes Jesus in your life, empowering you every day so you can be different. You can be different. I don't know. I bet you're going to see people all over this room this morning who no doubt look in the mirror and think, what are you doing here? Oh, everything goes bad for you. And they actually stand in the mirror and talk to themselves. I don't know what you're going to do today, girl. How you going to handle it today? They're looking in the mirror. I don't know how this is going to work. Well, I don't care how it works. Maybe I'll get through it. Maybe I won't. It's probably going to be like every other day. You've got a miserable life. When you can look in the mirror and hate what you see, that old person that's so hard to get along with, I mean, you snap everybody's head off. I'm just mad with the world. We didn't do it to you. You're mad at the wrong person. People treat you bad and you ain't did nothing. You think, well, what's going on? Just get out the way in the grocery line. Ma'am, hurry up. Could you hurry up, please? I'm trying to get through here. You should say, what's wrong? People are edgy. They're tense. They're uptight. They're trying to get through the day. I mean, yesterday was difficult enough. Here's another day I'm going to try to get through this. You got to be a very sad person. But would you like to switch that and change it? You can. You can change it. And be happy. Jesus was the only one that could make me happy. I tried a lot of things. None of them worked. None of them worked. He was the only one that could change me and make me into a new person so that I'm able to live in this world and do what I got to do and do it with joy. Not depressing. Depressing, nobody should be there. It's a horrible feeling. You see the commercial on TV sometimes where they're showing people who are depressed, and they say, a depression hurts. Yeah, it does. Because it gives you nothing. It takes everything from you, but it gives you nothing. So you got to ask yourself, sometimes when we make the mistake, we're going about it all wrong, trying to get these changes done, but we're doing it all wrong. We're going to the wrong people. And I want somebody to help me. We go to a psychologist. He needs help. Are you paying him? He said, who's he going to tell? I had a cousin that was a psychologist, and he said, boy, when I tell him at the end of the day, when I get to hear all these problems, he says, I'm telling you, I'm depressed myself. Because he's listening to you come in and whine and cry about what's wrong. God, Jesus makes the difference in your life. We spend too much time looking at other things that we think will work, and they don't work. They don't work. We go to all the wrong places, all the wrong people. You know why some people don't want to go to church anymore? There's nothing there. I mean, I went to church, man. I don't even know what that preacher was talking about. You don't know what I'm talking about. I guarantee you. You ever seen somebody went to church and it's a nice service today, so what did the preacher preach? Oh, I can't remember. What did he say? That's bad. That's bad. You need to remember what I say to you this morning. And if you remember nothing else, you remember that my life needs changing and I don't have the power to do it. I don't have the power. Listen to what Paul says. Paul says, for that which I do, I allow not. But what I hate, that do I. If then I do that which I would not want to do, I consent unto the law that is good. Now then, it is no more I that do it, but sin that dwelleth in me. So he says, what is this thing? The thing I want to do, I don't do it. But the thing I try to do, I can't make that happen. He said, I found out something was wrong inside. So he says, goes on to say, but for I know that in me, that is in this flesh, dwelleth no good thing. For to will is present. Then he says, but how to perform that which is good, I can't seem to find. I know that I should be able to do this, but what is it? I can't seem to get there. I tried this thing with religion. You don't need religion. You need salvation. You need God to change you, change your heart and your life, so that the power that's within me that is pushing me in the wrong direction I can stop that with him. So Paul says, for the good that I would, I don't do that. But the evil which I would not, that's what I'm doing. What is this? It's sin that's living in your heart. You got to get the heart cleansed of sin before you can start doing the good. Because out of a bad heart comes bad things. Out of a good heart comes good things. Now, if I do that, I would not. I found out it is no more I that do it, but sin that dwelleth in me. I found out sin's in me. Have you looked at your life this morning and said, you know what? I'm a sinner. I've been calling myself a Christian, but it has to tell you I'm a sinner. Something's wrong. He said, something inside is tormenting me. Something inside is pushing me. Something keeps making me take the wrong direction. I don't want to do it, but I keep doing it. This is what he said. So it's no more me, but sin in me. I find in a law that when I would do good, evil is present with me. When I want to do good, evil is always there to try to pull me the other direction. Because it's in the heart. Listen to this. For I delight in the law of God after the inward man, but I see another law in my members warring against the law of my mind and bringing me into captivity in the law of sin, to the law of sin, which is in my members. These are our members, our hands, our feet, all these things. If you yield it to wrong, it's going to do wrong. If you yield it to what's right, it'll do right. Think about it this morning. I need to change something. Why can't I do it? I mean, I've been to every church in this town. I'm still the same crazy person. What do I do to change that? There is a power that is far greater than you and any church in this community. Something has to happen between you and God. Nobody else can give it to you. Nobody else can change and do a major overhaul of all of us. Nobody but God. No matter how you try, no matter what you do, you can get some good people around and all this, but you got to get changed inside. You must be changed inside. Because I see a law warring in my members, and what I want to do good is pulling me the other direction. I don't want to go there, but I find myself going there. You had an affair on your wife. You said you'd never do that. I said, I'd never do that. And then I keep going back. What's wrong with you? I'm being controlled. And I know that, oh, no, I'm in control. No, you're not. I know I'm in control. You ain't even in control of that little bitty cigarette that's about this long. You ain't even got control of that. Oh, yeah, but if I don't want to smoke, I'm not going to. Once you form the habit and it gets you in its grip, you have to smoke. You have to do drugs. You have to do these things because now you're in a position that it's got you. You don't have it. You got to be able to say, no, I'm not doing that. And mean it because the devil knows whether you have the power or not. So you can't just stop doing drugs. I just cut it out. It ain't that simple. Because it's always there nagging at you, want you to come back to it, want you to come back. And you say, I don't want to go back. Oh, man, I'm going through some changes. I don't want to go back. But I find myself going that direction. When I know one thing, I'm in the middle of something that I said I wasn't going to do. It's a horrible feeling to be controlled by something else in your life. It's hard to want to like yourself. Because what you see, you know is not good. I don't have the power to change it. But Jesus said, come to me. All you that labor the heavy laden, come to me. I'll give you rest. Because that's tiring. Constantly trying to do it this way or that way is very tiring. What do I do? Stop. I gotta stop. Because if you don't stop, you're going to find yourself in a bad situation at the end of the day. If I only hadn't done that, if I only had not gone there, if I only had said no to that, get Jesus and you'll be able to say no. You'll be able to say, I'm not doing it. I don't want to profess to be a Christian, but when you see me everywhere else, you recognize real quick, it's not a Christian. when you're having sex outside of marriage, you're not a Christian. Read the Bible. It doesn't call you a Christian. That doesn't come from me. That comes from the Word of God. You cannot do that and be, well, Lord knows I'm weak. No, he said, let the weak say I'm strong. I came to give you strength. I come to help you to get over that. I came to give you the power to say no. Don't start talking about how weak you are. The Lord knows. He sure does. But that's why he came, to help you. And if we cry out to him, if we call out to him, he's going to do it. He will do it. You heard me. I said, Lord, I'm tired of Rose. I'm tired of her. I'm tired of being this mean, ornery, no good person. And I don't have the power to change me. Would you please help me? Come into my heart and empower me over the sin that's dragging me down. I need help. I need help. You need to cry out for help. God can do it for you if you'll cry out for help. Ask for it. Sometimes we don't get because we don't ask. He said, ask and it shall be given. Seek and ye shall find. Knock on the door and it shall be opened to you. Come on. You do it. This morning, you can leave this building totally changed to another person. You don't have to be that crazy one came here this morning. You look okay. The outside looks okay. But it's only a moment around that person will tell you, something is wrong with them. Because we get so accustomed to looking like everything's okay. How are you doing? Oh, fine. And inside, everything is at war. Everything is torn. Everything is wanting to break loose. But you know, we've been taught in our society in many respects just act like everything is okay. Because you act like it's okay, don't make it okay. You got to deal with it. Go in there and say, wait a minute, I'm not okay. I'm not going to start lying about it. I'm not okay. I need to change. I need to be a better person. I need to have something going on good in my life. Talk out. When you go talk to other people, never talk to the person that's in the same hole you in. You can't get out and they can't help you out. There you are, down there depressed, he's depressed, or he's depressed, and y'all in the same dungeon. And nobody gets out. Because everybody is depressed. Trying to understand all this stuff. Can you imagine getting in a situation and you're an alcoholic and you want to stop drinking and you get with a drunk that's still drinking? He can't help you. You want to tell you know what, man? When I feel bad, I gotta get something to drink. Hey, have some. And you said, no, I don't need that. Oh, have some. It'll make you feel better. But it doesn't last. It doesn't last. We're so busy doing temporary fixes in our life, expecting permanent change. It's not gonna happen. You gotta have something permanent to happen in your heart as so that you can stay changed. And then God gives you a seal and he preserves you so that which I put in you, it won't go bad. It won't change. It won't switch out. Nobody ever told me that before, but it's true. You can do it. You can get out of there. You get with people that say, I don't want to get out. I don't really want to get out. It's okay like this. You know, I just get another bottle of whiskey. When I get through it, there's another one to help me through it. That's not the way to live. And that is not living. Stop for a minute and say, you know what? I need to get away from this drunk. This drunk keeps wanting to make me, hey, have some. Well, have a little bit. You keep saying no. You say, man, I'm happy today. As long as I'm drunk, I'm happy. You can't stay drunk. You can't do it. And people keep going that same way with drugs. They start off on a really light, and then after a while they make it a little stronger, and they go back, and they keep getting something stronger and bitter. And you know what? After a while they kill themselves. They overdose. Trying their best to be happy. Trying their best to fulfill my life. I want to be happy. I want to be excited. I don't want to get stuck here. You see people all the time. You look at them. You watch it on your job. Watch it when you go to the store. People are shopping. You'll see this look. don't see many people just come in, "Hi, how are you?" And if they did, somebody said, "Oh, what do you mean, how I am? I'm not good today. Are you good?" They get mad if it looks like you're doing good. You see, like you're so happy all the time. What is it with you? You got some bad days. And you said, "No, I really don't. I really don't." Oh, I don't believe it. Everybody has some bad days. It's not about me having a bad day. It's how I deal with the bad day. It's how I deal with it. I just want to be happy. I don't think nobody on this planet don't want to be happy. That's a great feeling, to be happy. I don't want to be sad. I want to be happy. I want to be able to get up in the morning and know this is going to be a good day because I said it's going to be a good day. This is the day the Lord has made. I will rejoice. I'll be glad in it. He made the day. He don't make bad days. What are you talking about? This is the day that God has made. I shall rejoice and be glad in it. No. You got a bad day? Oh, I don't. It's a good day. You can try to act positive about everything if you want to. Honey, you're no different from the rest of us. Get away from that person. They're bad news. I don't care if it's your mama, your grandpa, your son, your daughter, whoever is saying nasty little things to you. Get away from them. I said, "No, I'm not going to her house today. Oh, she pulls me down. Every time the phone rings, now we have what we call call ID on our phone. You really don't have to answer it if you don't want to." Oh, that Susie, honey. Whoa. She'll tie me up on that phone for the next hour, crying and crying about how bad life is. I'm not listening to that. By the time you get off the phone, you think, "Well, I guess life does suck." You thought it was doing pretty good for a while till you talk to Susie. And Susie just steadily whining and whining about everything. Get away from whiners. They're not good for you. They don't make you feel better. They only make you feel bad. And then they'll tell you, "Well, how's things going with you?" And you say, "Well, I'm going pretty good. I've got a good chance to get this job I wanted. And you know, I'm going to church now." And they say, "Yeah." Tell me how bad, what a hard time you have. Tell me that. I want somebody with me who's depressed. Tell me you're depressed. Tell me you're down. You didn't get the job. You're tired of looking. That don't fix nothing. Get away from them kind of people. They're not going to lift you up. They'll put you down. I used to go to the desk all the time and shake people's hand when they come to church. Of course, I got tired of sitting there. So I thought, by the time I go home, I have to pull my teeth together. So I quit going to the desk. Because you gotta smile at everybody. I don't mind smiling. But after you smile at people with the line back here, "How you doing? How you doing?" "Well, you can." I thought I came today. So I just quit going all together. And then I put my foot in my mouth. Some lady came to the desk and she took my hand. I said, "Oh, what does your baby do?" Oh, my God. She said, "I'm not pregnant." I said, "Oh." I thought, how do I get my foot out of my mouth on this one? And then she said, "But I'm going to the gym." I said, "Well, that's a good thing." I said, "Keep going. You'll get better." Her belly was bigger than any pregnant woman. I'm serious. And so I said, "When are you going to have your baby?" I don't ask nobody that anymore. Nobody. Because people may not be pregnant because they look pregnant. Just leave it alone, Rose. You run into all kind of people. A man came to the desk and shook my hand. And so when it was time for him to walk away, he turned to walk away and he just stood there. So I'm thinking, what's wrong? And my son standing behind me, he is so tickled. Because the man keeps doing this, but he's not moving. And so he said, "Ma'am, I got to wait till this other leg catch up." Okay. "I'll get this leg catch up. I said, "Oh, okay." And my son said, I had to excuse myself. He gets to the back and he's cracking up. Wondering if this man stuck at the this and can't move. And we don't know why he's there. Or he shook my hand with that word, and now, and he's not moving. Sometimes we allow situations to just mess us up. I thought about Steve Harvey not long ago when they had the, I think, Miss America pageant or one of the pageants. And he crowned the wrong woman. He said he was so depressed. He said his wife said, honey, it's going to be okay. He said, I was so depressed. I thought, you had something to be depressed about. By the time this woman got the crown, you said, no, take it off her, put it on her. Oh. You'd be surprised at people that have made mistakes in their life, that they live in that place forever. Look, forgive yourself, ask God to forgive you, and move on. You can't just sit there and whine and feel sorry for yourself. I don't know why things happen so bad for me. You know, sometimes I say, God, why me? Why not you? Everybody else going through some things. It's how we deal with our issues. It's how we deal with the crisis and the problems that come. How do you deal with it? That's what's going to make a difference. I can either shout it out or cry it out. What do you want to do? Well, I just think I'm just going to cry it out. Well, don't come over here because I ain't got time. I'm trying to get you to understand, no matter what's going on in your life, when you give it all to Jesus, you're going to have a great life and a great time. You're going to find happiness. This is what Paul said. Knowing this, that our old man is crucified. Talk about the old person that I used to be. I now crucify. It's not living anymore. Anything we crucify dies, okay? And so it says, I crucify him that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. I won't become a servant of sin if I get rid of it. He said, for he that is dead is free from sin. If your body goes through a metamorphosis, spiritually speaking, you're not going to have anything else to deal with. It's dead. Anything that's dead don't give you a problem. Have you noticed that? That husband treated you so bad, he's in the cemetery now. He can never give you a problem. He's dead. Everything that's dead cannot trouble you. It's just living stuff walking around that gives you a hard time. Okay? So he said, no one says that our old man is crucified with him. Now if we be dead with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him. Knowing that Christ, being raised from the dead, dies no more. Death has no more dominion over him. For in that he died unto sin once. But in that he liveth unto God. So Jesus came and died for you. And he got up out the grave. And now you don't have to have it no more. He says, look, I made it possible. I made it possible for you to be free now. I'm giving you all that you need for you to be free. You got to tell yourself, I'll take it. Have you ever seen somebody? Does this make sense? Somebody comes to you and says, God, I'm hungry. You say, well, I got some food in there. You're welcome to. God, I'm hungry. You go in there, fix my place and hear. They said, that's all you need to eat. God, I'm hungry. No, I'm not going to eat. No. Thanks, but no thanks. You ain't hungry. That's the same way we come to God. Oh, Lord. I need you to help me. He says, well, give it to me. Well, no, Lord, I think I can fix it. I'm used to fixing things. After a while, where is this going to stop? Lord said, give it to me. And you say, well, okay. Well, now, just give me a little more time with it. By that time, you done aged 10 years. You look bad. Your nerves are shot. Man really believes he's the answer to his own problems. But he's not. You got to let God take care of that. I'm not going to carry anything on me that I can't change. If you don't have the power to change it, give it to God. Because that's where it needs to be, not with you. I want to leave from here today. You'll take the words that you heard this morning and you use them. The words are power. They are power. Use them. Paul said, oh, wretched man that I am. Who shall deliver me? Who shall get me out of this mess? to fix this? Who's going to make it work? He said, I can't do it. He said, but I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord, he can do it. I thank God we have a way out. I thank God because he can empower me. I thank God because I can get up in the morning with a new smile, a happiness in my heart, a reason to live. Through Jesus Christ. So if you think he can't change, I thank God. Through Jesus Christ. If he can change me, he can change you. There's nothing too hard for him. Everything he did for us, he did it because he loved us and cared about us. See, I know life can be very difficult without God. There's so many issues, so many unexpected things that we're not expecting that comes our way, and we're in this position and we need a way out. And quit running to people. People's not the answer. I always talk to Susie. You know, somehow she lifts me every time. Except one day you go there and Susie says, what is it that you want today, baby? He said, well, I come over to see you to talk. Honey, I ain't got time to talk to you. I got my own issues today. There's some bad things happening. I thought my husband was playing on me. I ain't got time to be talking to nobody. And anything, I want somebody to talk to me. You know, I always talk to Susie. Quit leaning on people. They have bad days. And you have to show up on one of them. Or they didn't answer the phone. He said, Susie, I called you. Honey, I just couldn't talk to nobody. I wasn't in the mood. People get depressed. They isolate. They get by themselves. They go into this little room, pull the shades down. We had a lady in our church years ago. She was a Mexican lady, and that's when we were in Germany. And she was really fighting not to eat wrong. So when she was going to eat bad, she closed all the blinds. I thought, that's not nobody. Whether nobody sees you or not. She closed all the blinds and sit down and eat like a hog. And I'm thinking, what was the blinds about? You're on the second floor. It's not like you're on the first floor. And if you won't, go ahead and eat your bread. But you know you can eat the whole loaf. Just the whole thing. The whole thing. And come out depressed and crying. And don't want to be fat. And you have to stop eating whole loaves of bread. That's something you got to do. They always ask people that lost weight, how did you do it? It's about eating right and working out. Those two things most people don't like. Eating right. And if you're black, you want it all crispy and fried as crispy as you can get. You know that's the truth. We'll fry anything. It doesn't matter. If you could, you'd fry the hog's toe. And tell yourself there's some nutrition in it. It's true. As black people, most of us, not all of us, but most of us are raised on a bad diet. You don't know anything different. I never heard of a fat gram until I was married and grown and left home. Fat gram, what is that? That's what's on your legs. Fat gram, that's what's in your tush. Nobody ever mentioned that. Whatever they put before you, we ate. Never worried about it. You start getting older and growing up and what have you, and you start thinking, I need to change this. I thought about my brother that just passed away. His aorta literally ruptured some years ago. And I went home so I could see him if he was in intensive care. And they repaired the aorta, which is usually never done. And so the doctor said, when you go home, eat no fat and no salt. Stay away from it. His wife says, I go look at us, and I said, are you going to fix that for him? Oh, yeah, me and Robert, we're going to eat this. I thought, you're going to have a ruptured aorta if you don't stop. You couldn't say nothing to it. No, no, they're going to do that. Now when he dies, he had a concussion where he hit his head on the step. And they done the brain surgery and got it out okay. But now they find that the aorta split again. We need to go in and redo it. And my brother said, no, I don't want you to. I don't want to go back to that surgery. Do you know some of the things that's happening to us in our physical bodies coming from what we do to it? It's what we do to it. In whatever way I can, climb it in. Climb it in some more. I'm full, but it's going down the hatch. We do it. If you know something is going to hurt you or kill you, you think you wouldn't do it? It's like you see people smoking cigarettes. Do you know what the Surgeon General said about that? And you're still doing it? Come on. You're still doing it. Every time I see somebody with a cigarette, I think, are you kidding me? You smoke. Now, it's going to give you cancer of the throat, cancer of the lungs, cancer in many places. And you keep right on doing it. Just keep doing it. Stop for a minute and say, what am I doing to myself? God helps you, and there's things you have to help you. You got to say that. I went home, most of my sisters and brothers all had nitroglycerin tablets on their tongue. All high blood pressure. All sugar diabetes. It's about every disease you can have. Watch what you put on the table. Now, he comes to give us control, discipline. That's a part of who God is. I'm going to give you discipline. I'm going to help you get through the situation. But we don't listen to it. Ah, here comes the Lord talking about a salad today. I don't know salad. I want something else over here. No, he's trying to teach you. Will we listen? Your life can be miserable because you made it miserable. You're having a difficult time because you've done things to make it difficult. Your car is bent up and broke and ain't doing good. You drive it like people driving a horse. Drive the car within reason. When it needs a maintenance done on it, take it to have it done. And come into church on, you know, the devil is a lie. The devil didn't do nothing to your car. That's you. Go get it fixed. And then you better deal with the issue. That when the thing gets so old, that's why they keep making new ones. When it gets so old, I don't care what you do to it, it's going to sit down on you somewhere. Don't call it the devil. I just got out and told that God, I rebuke you in the name of Jesus. It ain't going to do nothing. Don't waste your time, baby. Cars don't respond to rebuke. They don't. Look at your life and you know what? You're mad because you couldn't get where you was going. You couldn't make it to the job because of this or because of that. Come on. Come on. I got to take care of some things. This morning, you hear this message telling you what God can do for you. Now, if you want him to do it, you need to get in the prayer line. Come up here. I'm going to pray for people in just a few minutes. And come up here and say, "Sister, pray for me. I really got some things messed up here. I need to get it right." You don't have to tell me what it is. He already knows. You know. It's between you and him. But you can say, "Pray for me. I need to change. I need a new life. I need to be able to have different thoughts. I need to start thinking positive about things and not so many negatives. How do I get there?" You get there with him. He'll help you. This morning you're sitting there saying, "You know what? I've been wanting a way out and trying to get things changed, and boy, it looks like that this is the way that God is telling me I need to do. He's giving you some advice. He's giving you some counsel. This is what you want to do. How can you change it?" You can change it right through this if you'll go that way. You got to quit saying, "Well, I don't want to do. I have to do all this." Yeah, all of that. But what you get in return is uncomprehendable. You can have better. You can live better. You can have a good, enriched life. Feeling good every day. You know why some of us don't feel good? We encircle our lives with people who are always whining and crying about something that never happened. You can see them 7 days a week and they'll tell you something bad. Those type of people you don't need to be around. I need to find me some people. I need to start going to church and get involved with good church people, not hypocrites. Every church has a few hypocrites in it. Don't hook up with them. Hook up with people that's going somewhere. I used to tell my son when they were in school, I said, be friends with the kids that's making straight A's. Don't hook up with the ones making F's, or you gonna make F's. Get with people who's really wanting to go somewhere, who's planning, who got goals set for their life. Get with some of them. Don't do it. You don't have to run with the wrong crowd. A lot of things going on with you come from the people you have in your life. Make changes. But what if my husband ignored him? Ignore him. My husband was, he liked to argue. And he told me one day, he said, honey, my school teacher told me one time, you know, Charles, I think you'd argue with a lamppost if it answered back. He probably would. So sometimes something would come up, and I said, well, honey, I don't think that's it. He said, well, the way I look at it, I said, well, yeah. I said, but I don't think it. Well, the way I look at it, close the door. I said, you got that. He said, I don't want it. In other words, I want to argue. I'm not arguing with you. Not you ain't gonna just pass it off like that, Rosa. Come on. I'm not doing it. I don't feel like it. He just like a good argument. I'm not giving it to you. And then I say, okay, baby, it's yours. Don't try to get out of it like that. I'm not trying to get out of it, I'm just not doing it. This morning, if you're one of those people that I've been talking about this morning, says Sister Rose, I'm one of those people. I'm one of those people. I had a preached a message last Sunday about how the Lord said Israel had backslid so many times, he called Israel a backsliding helper. And this woman got in the line, are you here? She got in the line. She said, honey, I'm one of them helpers you were talking about. I never laughed, so I thought, I don't believe that. I'm one of them helpers. And the helper's back this morning. And she didn't laugh about it. She was a helper. She knew it. She didn't get mad with me. I didn't call her by name because I didn't know she was a helper. And she's laughing with me this morning. Sitting right back there laughing. You know what? You got to be a person that laughs at some things. Go on. Be able to laugh. But don't keep laughing at yourself till you get to hell. Make some changes. You got to make some changes. And this ain't funny. So what she said was good. If she keeps coming, she's not going to be one of those helpers. Her life is going to change like yours will. He changed me, he can change you. Musicians, please come forward. Yes. So if you're sitting there this morning, you want prayer, would you please stand? Everybody stand, please. And then if you want prayer, you can come forward. If you don't, that's okay. If you need to change and you know you need to change, you ought to do it. Yes. Yes. Life can be sweet, huh? Life can be sweet every day if you really want it. You know what you should say? I'm going home different today. I'm going home different. I am not going to be the same person that came in this building. I'm sorry. I'm tired of her. Get rid of her. Don't let her come back. Him come back. Say, you know what? I'm not doing it. You don't have to. You don't have to do it. He wants to help you get through it.